Assalamualaikum and good morning. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Dr. Nor Afdzillah. I am currently heading the colorectal surgery and I'm a consultant colorectal surgeon. I'm very honored that we have been given the opportunity to share a bit of knowledge with one of our interesting cases. So the title today is a clinical pathological conference, and our topic is on the eccentricity of Crohn's disease. So let me just introduce our panelists first. I'm very lucky to have them to join us today. So first of all, it'll be Dr. Nabil, who is our specialist, who is interested in colorectal surgery. He will be presenting the case, followed by our esteemed radiologist, Dr. Ho Shuang Yi. She will be presenting the images associated with the patients. And Dr. Wan Shahira is our consultant pathologist. She'll be supervising her trainee pathologist, Dr. Sumaya, who will be presenting the pathology findings, followed by Dr. Khairul Najmi, who is our consultant gastroenterologist and also hepatologist. He's a physician. He has been managing this patient from the start, and he will tell you a bit about the medical management. And last but not least, we will welcome Dr. Somabalaganapati, who is our specialist and also interested in colorectal surgery, who will discuss about the surgical management and surgical side of management of Crohn's disease. Without further ado, I would like to invite Dr. Nabil to share with us the case.
Assalamualaikum and a very good morning to everyone. Thank you, Ms. Nora, for the kind introduction. Again, my name is Nabil Mohammad Azmi. I am a specialist currently in colorectal unit from the Department of Surgery, Faculty of Medicine, University Kebangsaan Malaysia. So I'm delighted to share with you about the case summary about the patient that we are going to present today. So this is a lady of 22 years old age. She initially presented to us with a history of lethargy as well as lower abdominal pain of 2 months duration. She had a history of loss of weight, about 18 kilograms within a month. She was referred to our hospital in Shiraz, Hospital Chancellor Tuanku Mukris HCTM, from a private hospital for further management. At that point of time, workup has been done that includes CT scan of the abdomen as well as colonoscopy. She was initially treated under our esteemed gastroenterologist from the medical department. As the chronology, colonoscopy was performed by us back in October last year. Upon that time, the colonoscopy showed large cecal ulceration with colonic stricture. Due to this stricture, the colonoscopists were unable to pass through beyond the stricture. So at this point of time, multiple biopsies were taken and it turns out to be Crohn's disease. Subsequently, this patient was started on treatment. In this case, she was started on tablet azathioprine of 75 milligram once a day. She responded well to the treatment. She was well for about 6 months until she presented again to us back in May 2023. At this point of time, she presented with a history of abdominal pain and lethargy. So upon clinical examination, she appeared to be lethargic looking, but not septic. The abdomen examination revealed tenderness over the right aleft fossa, and there were no palpable mass. Other examination were unremarkable. So at this point of time, sorry, I have to change to a different slide. Can you see the slide? So the blood investigation reveals hemoglobin of 11, YSA count was 4.9, platelet was 309. The renal profile were fairly unremarkable, in which there is no derangement of the renal function. The creatinine was 38, urea is 1.7, sodium was 140, and potassium was 3.5. These are the liver function test results. The albumin...
Sorry, Dr. Nabil, can you change your slide? You're seeing the same slides.
Oh, okay. Can you see the slide? Yeah, sorry. So I will shall continue with my presentation. So as I mentioned earlier, the albumin were E38, ALP of 104, AST of 32, and ALT is 29. The erythrocyte sedimentation rate were 22 and LDH at 44, or 4. So as part of the workup, as part of the differential diagnosis, we have to rule out TB of the gut, in which workup has been done by our medical colleagues. Chest X-ray were fairly unremarkable. Mentu tests that was performed were also negative. However, the gamma quantiferon were found to be indeterminate. What I was told by our medical colleague is that due to this indeterminate result, we have to rule out pulmonary tuberculosis. So therefore, they have arranged a bronchoscopy and lavage that was done by our pulmonologist, in which the samples of the fluid taken were sent for a gene expert evaluation, and the result turned out to be negative. Virus screenings were also performed, in which the hepatitis B and C and retroviral disease result were found to be negative. So what I'm showing to you now is the picture of the colonoscopy. The picture is showing you the ascending colon. We can actually appreciate the fact that there is inflammation of the mucosa. The mucosa appears to be pale, suggests unhealthiness of the mucosa. And we can actually appreciate that there is evidence of stricture located at the ascending colon. That's why I think at this point of time, the colonoscopists were unable to advance the scope beyond this stricture. So there's a traces of blood here. And for your information, it is due to the biopsy taken. And as I mentioned earlier, the biopsy turns out to be a Crohn's disease. So armed with this new found information, another CT scan of the abdomen was arranged. And to give us a summary, an overview, this lady was rather unfortunate. She was not only diagnosed to have a Crohn's disease, she in fact has the end of spectrum of this disease, in which there's already complication as a result of uncontrolled Crohn's disease. She has colonic stricture, and CT abdomen showed there is a fistulation, another features of Crohn's disease. So from this CT scan of the abdomen, we found that there is a multiple fistulous tract communicating between the, what I can recall from the right ascending colon to the transverse colon, and multiple fistula communication between the loops of the small bowel. And to make things worse, there is an evidence of right iliac fossa collection. So at this point of time, for the patient's benefit, we have decided to consult with our interventional radiologist, in which we have arranged for a percutaneous drainage to drain this collection, and as much as 80 mils of serous fluid were drained. As part of the investigation, we have arranged for a magnetic resonance enterography to further ascertain the extent of her bowel disease. So after much deliberation and counseling, the surgical team were consulted by the gastroenterologist, and we have actually counseled the patient and the family members. And we had to perform a laparotomy with right hemicolectomy with double barrel stoma creation. The indication were very clear. Patient has been having persistent abdominal pain with unresolved sepsis. So these are the intraoperative specimen. Usually we have oriented the specimen correctly, but to aid in your understanding, I've labeled this specimen according to the region of the bowel. What we can appreciate from here is that generally the bowel appeared to be edematous, inflamed, it looks angry, and you can actually appreciate that there is a phlegmon formation at the ileocecal region. And to find out here, there is already an evidence of multiple strictures at the affected small bowel. And the specimen was sent to the pathologist for further evaluation. I think that's all from me. I would like to pass the session to our esteemed radiologist, Dr. Ho Shuangli, to describe further about the CT scan as well as the MR enterography further. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nabil. Now I'll be showing my slide. Okay, so today I'll talk about the imaging of Crohn's disease for this unfortunate patient. Before I start with the presentation of the scan, I think everyone knows that Crohn's disease is a complex chronic inflammatory gastrointestinal condition with variable age of onset, disease location, and behaviors. The role of imaging is in aiding of diagnosis, detection of active disease, as well as investigation of complications such as stricture, fistula, or abscess. The imaging modalities which can be used includes luminal fluoroscopic study. However, fluoroscopy has largely been replaced by cross-sectional imaging techniques nowadays, which includes CT enterography, MR enterography, as well as small bowel ultrasound. According to the British Society of Gastroenterology consensus guideline of management of IBD in adults, these three cross-sectional imaging techniques actually have no consistent difference in accuracy for Crohn's assessment. The sensitivity and specificity actually ranging about 85 to 95%. So for this patient, I'll be showing the imaging of a CT as well as the MR at the same time. So you guys can see a difference between these two imaging techniques. So the first image I would like to show is a fistulous tract. If you can see me labeling here as a S is a sigmoid colon. At the superior aspect of the sigmoid colon, you can see there's a tract tracking superiorly, which is a fistulous tract. A similar appearance can also be seen on a CT. So now if we move cranially at the pelvic region, we can see the above mentioned fistula actually show branches and communicates with ileal loops at the pelvic region, which is shown in the red lines in MRI. And on the right side is a CT, which is also showing the similar findings. And the similar fistulous tract is also shown in this coronal view, where you can see the typical asteric appearance. This appearance is described with a center radiating pattern of the fistulous tract, which looks like an asteric. And you can see the CT and MRI shows a similar finding. Now I'll be showing changes over the ileocecal and terminal ileum region. You can see here there's a thickening over the terminal ileum, ileocecal junction area with mild upstream bowel dilatation. There's also collection seen over the right iliac fossa region. Similar changes in CT. And also, if you look at this coronal view, we can see a colocolic fistula. If you see the annotation here, the A and C indicates the ascending colon as well as the cecum. This part of the bowel are actually retracted. And you can see that there's fistulous tract coming out from this part of the bowel. And also one of the tract is seen communicating with this part of the bowel here, which is labeled as T, which is a transverse colon. So if you see in a CT, we can see a similar finding. And here, you will be seeing this part of the bowel, which labeled as a D, is actually a duodenum. You can see that there's a tract communicate with the duodenum with the above mentioned complex tracts. And there's also a collection forming over here. It's seen in this CT, and this is the collection mentioned. So lastly, I'll be showing one of the complications for this patient as well, which is an ileostenosis. You can see that's narrowing over this part of the ileal loop with an upstream bowel dilatation. And you can see this is there's a hypo-intense signal over the T2 weighted imaging, suggestive of a chronic changes. So similar finding can also be seen on a CT. So this is the last slide for this patient, and for previous presentation, I'll be showing the differences between a CT and MR. So you can see from both CT and MR, they are actually equally useful technique in assessing Crohn's disease, especially in the active phase. So when we want to choose regarding a CT or MR, the downside for CT is definitely for young patients where they need a repeated imaging assessment, the risk will be a radiation to exposure. And as for MRE, prolonged scanning time is a downside. So in conclusion, we conclude that from the imaging finding, the patient have an active Crohn's disease with a penetrating complication, which includes the complex fistulas, intra-abdominal abscesses, as well as ileostenosis. Before I end my presentation, I'll be showing a simplified illustration showing the complex fistula as well as the abscesses in this patient. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ho. That was very informative. I just have a question for the benefit of the medical students. I noticed in one of your slides that one of the investigation that we do for Crohn's is small bowel ultrasound. Yes. And I'm sure the medical students have been told that when you do ultrasound scan, you need absolutely no air interface between the probe and the organ. And we know that bowel has got a lot of gas. So can you explain to us how this is performed?
Actually, for let's say you compare with a CT and MRI, for CT and MRI, to get an optimum scan, you actually have to distend the patient with oral fluid so that the bowel distension is optimum. But as for ultrasound, you actually don't have to do that. And if the patient have an abnormal thickening of the bowel, you can actually see it better because you see the lumen have an air and there's thickened wall. So actually from ultrasound, you can detect the thickened wall. Even though, I mean, this is how you understand that air is not a very good object to scan, but actually it helps us to detect the lumen and also for the wall. So actually ultrasound is a very simple and easy way to perform.
Thank you, Dr. Ho. So we will proceed with the pathology presentation. So I believe Dr. Sumaya is representing the pathology unit. So without further ado, please welcome Dr. Sumaya.
Assalamualaikum and a very good morning to everyone. Okay, I'm Sumaya Zaihan, medical officer in pathology. So we receive the specimen right hemi collectomy for this patient, which is composed of a loop of ileum, cecum, and as well as the ascending colon. As you can appreciate from the image of this gross picture, the ileum is adhered together to each other, very severely adhesion, and there are multiple strictures that you can appreciate. And the appendix is seen embedded within the ileocecal area. There are actually multiple ulcer that is seen throughout the specimen, but there is this one deep fissuring ulcer that you can see in the ileum. And upon microscopic finding, there are mucosal ulceration with loss of crypts here, which is also replaced by granulation tissue. And the deep fissuring ulcer is seen cutting through the muscularis propria with surrounding heavy inflammation by the chronic inflammation cell, which is the lymphocyte and plasma cell. And within the ascending colon, there are two fistula that is seen, which is corresponding to the CT finding that we see just now. And microscopically, you can see in this area, there is heavy mucosal ulceration. The muscularis propria is disrupted, causing this perforation. And the surrounding, there is mixed inflammatory cell infiltrate with granulation tissue formation. Apart from that, within the ileal area, we see multiple strictures just now. And upon sectioning, there is multiple polyp-like mucosal protrusion measuring around 1 to 2 mm in this area. And if you can see from the right image, this polyp-like area is actually pseudopolyps. There is no dysplasia or evidence of chronic inflammation seen in the polyp-like, the pseudopolyp. And in this case, there are evidence of chronicity to favor the chronic disease in such as Crohn's disease, which is, you can appreciate the crypt irregularity, the crypt branching here, and also flattening of villi, which is not seen in this picture. Apart from that, the splaying of the muscularis mucosae, which is usually just nicely sitting at the basal layer in one layer, but in this case, there is splaying of the muscularis mucosae in the submucosal area. But from that, you can appreciate that the muscularis propria is thickened and the nerve bundle hypertrophy is also evident in this case. However, there is no granuloma that is observed in this case, which is not something that is peculiar. Only 1/3 of the case of Crohn's actually cause granuloma. So when we encounter a case of Crohn's disease, it's always important to exclude intestinal tuberculosis because there are reported cases that intestinal tuberculosis reported as Crohn's in the first place because it mimics Crohn's. Because these two entities actually can occur in both large and small intestine, being the commonest site of these two are the ileocecal area. But bear in mind that Crohn's disease can occur along the tract of GI tract, can occur anywhere along the GI tract. And these two entities also occur in segmental or in skip lesion, but rarely the TB can cause diffuse tuberculosis colitis. And in TB, usually the ulcer is superficial ulcer, but it can also cause deep ulcers such as Crohn's disease and cause transmural inflammation. And in TB, if you are lucky enough, you can see the caseating granuloma, but in early case, it cannot be non-caseating granuloma. But in Crohn's, usually the granuloma is of non-caseating. So in such case that we see granuloma, we always need to exclude this TB. In our case, in our pathology, we will do the Zeal-Nielsen stain lah, to see the acid fast bacilli. And culture study and also PCR can also help to exclude TB in such case. And these two entities also can complicate with fistula, sinuses and perforation. Okay. However, for ulcerative colitis, we know that this entity usually affect the colon only. The involvement is diffuse and usually it starts distally and then progress proximally. And the ulcer is most of the time is superficial, which is limited to the mucosa. And there is no granuloma or complications such as fistula or sinus that can occur. On the other hand, irritable bowel syndrome is, we know it is a real symptom of chronic relapsing abdominal pain with bloating and changes in bowel habit, but the endoscopic and microscopic evaluation are usually normal in such case. With that, I thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sumaya. Perhaps Dr. Wan Shahira can elaborate a bit more on my next question. As a medical student, I do find sometimes inflammatory bowel disease can be quite confusing between the two. And is it possible for you to explain to us the typical findings that you can find in pathology of Crohn's, and in this patient, what was true and what was not?
Okay, so in this patient, basically for inflammatory bowel disease, it's really important to correlate with clinical findings, and the colonoscopy findings also important to know whether the lesion is segmental, is it diffuse, does it involve the whole colon or only certain parts, and whether the main finding is in the ileocecal region. So all of these features are in favor of Crohn's disease or TB. So based on that, we look at the microscopic finding, and there are certain features which favor Crohn's, such as deep inflammation, because ulcerative colitis will be more superficial, and also whether there are any granulomas. Presence of granuloma would be really, really helpful, but we look really hard for granuloma in this case, which was not there.
Thank you, Dr. Wan Shahira. Does Dr. Najmi want to elaborate further, since he sees a lot of inflammatory bowel disease?
Thank you, Ms. Laura. Can you hear me, everyone? Hello?
Yes, we can.
Okay, good. Okay. So I do agree with the pathologist. Correlation with, especially with the endoscopic features, is very important. In fact, to diagnose Crohn's or UC, you have to take everything into account, including clinical and also biochemical features as well. So endoscopically, how we can differentiate between UC and Crohn's, UC usually start from rectum and then extend proximally, usually diffuse in terms of the type of ulceration, usually it's superficial, and it can be widespread, it can be small ulcer as well. And then in terms of Crohn's disease, usually there will be a skip lesion. For example, in one segment of the colon, let's say in the descending colon, you might see a focal area of inflammation, the redness of the mucosa, fibre, a bit of ulceration. And then on the opposite side of the mucosa, at the same segment, it looks normal. So that's what we say as a skip lesion. So to be honest, Again, in Crohn's, they also can present with a diffuse distribution of inflammation of the colon. Again, they also can start from the rectum, extending proximally. That's why it's important to correlate with the histological findings. Sometimes we might initially diagnose a patient with UC, but eventually, later on during the course of the disease, patient actually end up having a Crohn's disease.
Thank you, Dr. Najmi. I think it's definitely very, very important that we take a really thorough history when we see our patients, because I think the history is very important to help our radiologists and also our pathologists to aid the diagnosis. Dr. Najmi can continue with his presentation regarding medical management.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum and very good morning to everyone. So just going to talk briefly on the overview of the medical management of inflammatory bowel disease. This is my outline for today, a bit on local epidemiological data. And then we talk about the treatment approach and an overview of the biologic therapy. So based on our paper, we analyze our patient in HTM for the last four decades. And then we found that the incidence of IBD, regardless either UC or CD, is increasing. And then for the last decade, the mean crude incidence of IBD was 1.4 over 100,000 per population. And we can see also the incidence of UC is higher than CD, but the gap is decreasing. In terms of the prevalence among the ethnic Indian actually is the most prevalence race that have IBD, both CD and Crohn's, followed by the Malays and also the Chinese. In terms of the socio-demographic characteristic, when we compare between the UC and Crohn's disease.
Can I just interrupt for a second? For those of you who are not talking, can you please mute your mic? Can you please mute your mic, viewers? Thank you. Sorry, Dr. Najmi, can continue.
All right. No problem. So when we compare between UC and CD group, in terms of the gender, there is slight male predominance in the UC patient. And then when we look at the mean age of diagnosis, usually patient with Crohn's diagnosed younger compared to UC, at the mean age of diagnosis about 27 years old for the Crohn's disease and 41 years old for ulcerative colitis. When we look at the disease characteristic of our IBD patient in terms of the location, based on Montreal classification, UC patient, most of the patient have left-sided and extensive colitis. And then when we look at the Crohn's disease, majority of them have ileocolonic disease. When we look at the behavior of Crohn's disease, they usually have three main behavior. Number one is inflammation, which is non-stricturing, non-penetrating. Number two is stricturing. Number three is penetrating, when patient already developed intra-abdominal abscess. So majority of our patient remains in the non-stricturing, non-penetrating disease, but good to know about 13% of them have concurrent perianal disease. And then when we look at the treatment-wise, it's quite old data. For the last 4 or 5 years, we have more patient has been on biologic treatment. But again, when comparing between UC and CD patient, more patient with biologic in the Crohn's disease group, and then in terms of surgical intervention, similarly, Crohn's disease patient were having more surgical intervention as compared to the UC patient. So how do we treat IBD? So the traditional treatment goal of IBD, probably before the era of immunomodulator, before the era of biological therapy, the main is to control the symptom of the patient, usually with a steroid. Hopefully, it can induce the remission and improve the quality of life. But in the last 20 years, the aim has been shifted. We aim for treat to target strategy where patients have been monitored periodically, and then we should aim for mucosal healing endoscopically, and then ideally we should achieve a deep remission, and not just clinical remission, not just endoscopic remission, but hopefully with a histological remission as well. And then eventually what we hope is to change the course of the disease. So in terms of the treatment approach, for the sake of medical student, always remember the aim to treat IBD first is to induce the remission, and number two is to maintain remission. And usually for the induction, we can use either mesalazine for UC, not for Crohn's, and steroid for Crohn's and UC as well. And then the mode of administration of the steroid depending on the severity of the IBD. In mild to moderate, you might start on high dose of oral prednisolone. In severe or moderate to severe cases, you might admit the patient and start the patient on intravenous hydrocortisone. And then in terms of the approach, again, there is always a treatment pyramid, where traditionally there is a conventional step-up therapy, where we start with the lowest side effect of the medication. Usually we induce with steroid or mesalazine, and then we maintain the remission with continued mesalazine in UC patient. And in Crohn's disease, usually we start with the immunomodulators such as azathioprine. And then along the monitoring of the patient, if the patient keep having a relapse, and then patient will be introduced to the next treatment, which is usually in biologic, and eventually might need a surgery if a failed medical therapy. But recently we've been shifted from mainly traditional conventional step up, we changed to there's another approach called the top-down approach.
I'm sorry, is Dr. Khairul Najmi breaking up, or is it just my computer?
Yeah, now it's clear.
Okay, yep.
Okay. So with the top-down approach, usually we start with the biologic first to induce the remission, and then we'll be maintained with the biologic and plus-minus introduction of immunosuppression. We do acknowledge in our country, financial is a big issue. The cost for biologic therapy usually more than 20K per year. So rather than, it might be difficult to adopt a top-down approach. So what we do is accelerated step-up approach, where we start with the conventional according to the pyramid ladder, but we aim for early introduction of the biologic in certain, especially in severe cases. So a bit of a timeline of the IBD and the treatment. The first approval of anti-TNF is around 1990s, but the first use of anti-TNF, which is the Remicade or Infliximab, is in 1998. And then after that, 2015, the second line or second class vedolizumab, which is the gut selective agent, was introduced. And then recently, about 5 years ago, ustekinumab has been launched and been used as well in the IBD patient. So these are the biologic that's available in Malaysia. We have anti-TNF alpha, commonly used in infliximab, adalimumab, and then we have anti-integrin, which is gut selective, in the name of vedolizumab. And that another one is ustekinumab, which is anti-IL-12 and 23. Pre-biologic screening is very important because there's a side effect associated with biologic, especially reactivation of latent infection, malignancy, and a few other things. So virus screening, especially hepatitis B, C, and HSV, has been done, and then we need to detect any active or latent TB. So usually we screen patients with chest X-ray, IGRA test, QuantiFERON or T-spot, plus minus MEN2 test, although MEN2 is slightly less sensitive if patient already have BCG vaccine. And then usually we screen a patient for varicella zoster virus as well, in case they are not immunized against the chickenpox or the shingles. And then we usually make sure patient is vaccinated up to date, Hep B, pneumococcal, influenza, herpes zoster, and then annually patient should be counseled for skin check in terms of the risk of skin cancer. So just a bit summary in terms of the biologic therapy in IBD, I would like to highlight in terms of the efficacy of the induction. Anti-TNF-alpha seems to be more efficient in view in terms of the rapid onset of the action. Usually patients feel better after 1 or 2 weeks of the first dose as compared to Vido or ustekinumab, probably will take a few weeks. However, in terms of maintaining the efficacy, anti-TNF alpha have a tendency to lose the response after 1 or 2 years as compared to Vido or ustekinumab. And in terms of the other features, crystallizing EIMs,
Najmi, we can't hear you.
Okay, sorry, my microphone. So in terms of positioning of the biologic, in patients who are not on biologic therapy, so the first line, we can use infliximab, second line, adalimumab or ustekinumab, and then Vido will be the third line in Crohn's disease. However, in UC patient, we might use Vido as a first or second line. In patient with loss of response to the previous infliximab, I would suggest to use ustekinumab rather than vedolizumab. If we are concerned about the safety profile in elderly patient with a lot of comorbidities, with high risk of infection and malignancy, so rather than anti-TNF, ustekinumab or vedolizumab is probably a better choice. Patient with extra intestinal manifestation, especially the joint pain, anti-TNF alpha is the first line of the treatment. In patient Crohn's disease with fistulizing disease, again, anti-TNF alpha usually is the preferred option. And then in patient with bursitis post colectomy, Vido is a good option because it's gut selective. So this is my last slide, just to show that the behavior progression of the Crohn's disease is initially inflammatory in nature. It can develop into suturing disease, eventually fistulizing and abscess, which usually end up having surgery. So it's very important to diagnose early, close monitoring, and then adopt a proper strategy, probably accelerated step-up approach in moderate to severe complicated Crohn's disease patient. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Najmi. That was very in-depth, I feel. In this lady, she's very young. She's 22 years old. She's single, and she's come with this penetrating stricturing disease. So it's at the end of the disease spectrum. So she didn't respond to conservative medical management, percutaneous drainage. We had to go in to do operation on her. So in the recovery period, I assume that you're using the same way of inducing and maintaining remission. So I suppose there's only one choice to induce, which is steroids. Is this, how would you kind of medically treat this patient?
Post-operatively, is it, miss?
Yes, yeah.
Okay, so the good thing with the surgery usually is clear up most of the inflamed or the troublesome or the culprit area, which in this case, the ascending colon, the ileum, although the fistulizing disease is there. So I won't treat the patient with steroid post-operatively. Antibiotic is very important, As we know, patient presented with intra-abdominal abscess, although it's been cleared quite a lot during the surgery. So the way I treat the patient, continue with antibiotic, probably at least for a month, and then re-imaging to make sure resolution of the intra-abdominal abscess. There's no rule for the steroid, especially clinically patient is quite well, asymptomatic, all the inflammatory markers coming down. I'm not worried about the luminal disease as much because most of the area has been taken out. So once the abscess is improved, I will start induce the patient with the biologic therapy, which in this case would be the anti-TNF-alpha, and then we'll maintain on that. Concurrently, I will start on the low dose of azathioprine as well, because we know that with the anti-TNF-alpha, there's a tendency to develop antibody, which might contribute to the loss of response later on. So I will start with the low dose, probably 15 milligram once a day, combined with the anti-TNF-alpha.
Thank you, Dr. Najmi. We will proceed to our last but not least speaker, Dr. Soma, regarding the surgical management.
Thank you, Ms. Nora. So, hi, thank you, Ms. Nora, again. And thank you, Dr. Najmi, for that very enlightening information. My name is Soma, and I'm a general surgeon attached with the colorectal unit. And my task for today is to highlight the surgical perspective in the management of Crohn's disease. So as we have was clearly elaborated by Dr. Najmi, the main bulk of the management is medical. Surgery per se does not cure Crohn's disease. However, surgical intervention ultimately helps or aids to relieve symptom complication, essentially improving the quality of life of the patient. The aim of surgery is to maintain or preserve the anatomy as well as the physiological function of the small bowel. Going back to the pathophysiology of Crohn's disease, the bulk of the inflammation occurs at the level of the bowel wall. And from our explanation from Dr. Sumaya and Dr. Najmi, we understand that it is usually uncontrolled inflammation transmurally leading to extensive tissue injury. Henceforth, Crohn's disease can manifest as ileocolitis, ileitis, gastroduodenal Crohn's disease, jejunal ileitis, granulomatous colitis, and perianal Crohn's. Due to this persistent transmural inflammation, they have several fates, which usually cause the complications of this disease, whereby continuous inflammation may result in acute hemorrhage, usually manifesting as lower GI bleeding. The inflammation can progress and cause, excuse me, internal fistulation to adjacent viscera, usually colocolic or enterocolic or enteroenteric. They may develop abdominal abscesses. Once the transmural inflammation fibrosis, they can cause a luminal obstruction, henceforth intestinal obstruction. The inflammation may progress to perforation of the bowel, malignant change, and perianal Crohn's. Now, when is surgery indicated for Crohn's disease? When there is a failure of medical management, usually in steroid recalcitrant patients, when we find there's a stunted growth, mainly in pediatric patients, when there's presence of bowel obstruction, free perforation, penetrating disease, fistulas, intra-abdominal abscesses, malignant change, toxic colitis, and gastrointestinal bleeding. So this is a paper by Yanni et al. These are a group of gastroenterologists who researched from Washington University in the States. They published this article in the Inflammatory Bowel Disease last year in July. So this group of researchers, they gathered, they did a cross-sectional study, gathering about 1,557 patients, which they categorized into several phenotypes of Crohn's disease. So they categorized them into the inflammatory phenotype, the stricturing phenotype, the penetrating phenotype, as well as those in combination of stricture and penetration. And they found that the majority of these patients were actually in the inflammatory phenotype. So in their research, they found that once Crohn's disease becomes complicated, being either a stricture or penetrating disease or in combination, they would ultimately require surgery. Zachary et al. From the Italian Society of Surgery has published his findings on a treatment algorithm proposed for Crohn's disease. And his treatment algorithm is quite understandable by this diagram here. When we find active Crohn's disease, it is essential that we ascertain whether this disease is complicated or not. If they're not complicated, we go back to the medical therapy and embarking them on immunomodulators or in biologics. However, if they are life-threatening, whereby the complications that we elaborated earlier, they would require emergent surgery. However, if they do not seem to have a life-threatening complication, we must first optimize these patients, remove the stressing agents, enhance the medical treatment, and more importantly, enhance nutrition, decide on drainage or diversion to aid the sepsis, and once the patient is optimized, put the patient up for elective surgery, which has several modalities, which I will elaborate further in the coming slides, being either a resection or structuroplasty. And once they have gone through the post-operative period, back to medical therapy, and most likely a lifelong surveillance. So management of Crohn's stricture. As we understand, the inflammation is usually at the level of the bowel wall transmurally. And once they heal, they develop fibrosis. This fibrosis can cause luminal narrowing and ultimately proximal bowel dilatation, which needs to be addressed. There are several modalities to deal with Crohn's strictures. One least invasive method would be by performing an endoscopic balloon dilatation. These are amenable for strictures that are accessible, number one, and who are short. They have a good success rate with a good immediate clinical efficacy. However, they may require repeated dilatation in about more than 50% of the time. And in 30% of patients who are rather refractory may require surgery within a year. Structuroplasties are done for patients who have not responded to earlier the endoscopic balloon dilatation or at a site which is not reachable by the endoscopic route. Hence, once a structuroplasty is done, there's a regression of disease at that site. However, it does not preclude this group of patients from recurrences at other sites in the GI tract. This is a form of a structuroplasty, which is done for shorter Crohn's strictures. It's termed as a Hennequin-Mikulic structuroplasty, whereby a longitudinal slit is made on the antimesenteric border of the bowel along the stricture and closing it at opposite angles, henceforth making the luminal diameter larger. For strictures that are longer, about 10 cm or so, a Finnish structuroplasty can be advocated, where a bowel loop along the stricture is brought together at the healthy part, and a slit is made at the strictured part, ultimately anastomosing it in a fashion to enhance the luminal diameter. For strictures that are longer, we could advocate a Michelassi structuroplasty. This is done for longer strictures, more than 20 centimeters, or when there's multiple small strictures involving a significant length of bowel. So this procedure entails overlapping the stricture segment and performing the anastomosis ultimately to aid the luminal diameter. In the recent past, not so recent actually, it's been more than a decade, a Kono S anastomosis can be advocated. A Kono S anastomosis actually involves, in the diagram that we can see, a longer segment of diseased bowel, which is surgically just resected. And then the healthy bowel is brought together and a slit is made at the antimesenteric border of the bowel, anastomosing in a fashion to ensure that the luminal diameter is enlarged. And you would pay attention to diagram G, you'd find that the anastomosis at the antimesenteric border and not at the mesenteric border where recurrent diseases usually occur. This group of researchers from the National University of Singapore published a review article assessing the effectiveness of Kono S anastomosis, and they found that this method actually has a very low anastomotic leak rate and a low recurrence rate. Now, coming back to when disease is complicated with a stricture or a or an intra-abdominal abscess or a fistula, they would ultimately require a segmental resection of the bowel with or without a stoma, as was the case for the patient that Mr. Nabil presented to us earlier. This group of researchers from Rio published a Rio article suggesting a treatment algorithm for the management of Crohn's abscesses. Now, it's important for us to understand that abscesses can be large or small, and smaller abscesses can be treated with antibiotics with or without the requirement of steroids. However, larger abscesses should be aided with a percutaneous drainage where deemed feasible. We have to keep in our mind that this group of patients eventually would require surgery. However, if they were amenable for a percutaneous drainage, it would lessen the burden, physiological stress and the burden on their body, henceforth reducing the morbidity and probably even avoiding a stoma. We have to bear in mind that these abscesses may present with perforation and peritonitis, inevitably requiring surgery at an emergent setting. This is a treatment algorithm for Crohn's abscesses. We take a small abscess lesser than 4 cm and larger abscesses more than 4 cm. Small abscesses can be amenable for medical treatment with or without steroid therapy. Where there's a success, we can subject the patient later for immunomodulators. However, if there's a failure, they may require a surgery, most instances requiring a stoma. If it's complicated in some time after the treatment, they may require a delayed surgery. However, if the abscesses are larger, more than 4 centimeters, we should discuss these patients whether they are amenable for a percutaneous drainage with the interventional radiologist. If they succeed, they may run away from surgery. However, if it fails, they will require a surgery, obviously. In complicated conditions, they require delayed surgery, as we mentioned earlier. So in summary, surgery is an adjunct in the management of Crohn's disease, and surgical intervention is definitely inevitable and essential in complicated Crohn's disease and in emergent conditions, keeping in mind that doing less may be more for our patient. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Soma. I think your summary page is very important, since our patients are mainly young and very malnourished, and they may need repeated surgery. So we also need to bear in mind that we need to build them up nutritionally to prevent post-operative complications as well. I would like to congratulate the panel. Thank you very much for your involvement in today's CPCs. Greatly appreciated. Hopefully we can work together again. So for the Zoom faculty, Perubatan, I think we can start the quiz.